My. Well, I've got a lot of different things I can minister on, and I know this is a Sunday morning, and I could probably talk longer than you can listen, so I'll be sensitive to the fact that it's sake of time. But at the same time, though, I do want to impart something that I believe is important today in the area of prayer. And, you know, it's an area that I haven't ministered on quite a bit, but I do talk on quite a bit of areas in the area of healing and receiving healing from God. In fact, I've got teaching back on the table on how to receive healing from God that's about, I think it's about 10 hours altogether. It's a part one and part two. And it's probably the most thorough teaching I've done in that area because I was teaching students and I was teaching, you know, hour after hour. And so I was being as complete as I possibly could be to give as much understanding just on the subject of receiving. And so the insights that are there, I believe, are wonderful because, again, receiving from God is about Jesus. It's not about us, but it is for us. But in the context of coming for prayer, again, if we're not careful, when the time comes that we actually come for personal ministry, you know, our brother was sharing earlier about the program that with addictions and helping people in that area, and he was stressing the point of the fact that it's not a program because, you see, is the Word of God is going to be ministered, and there's a dependency on the Spirit of God when... In fact, I'll just say it this way. There are things that people do that are good. You know, like as an example, like the little boy with autism. His mother was dropping him off at a special education school. There's nothing wrong with that. Those people, I'm sure they care about those children. I'm sure they're in that line of work because there was something within their heart that they wanted to help someone and do someone else. And so they've established their heart in the natural realm with natural knowledge and training to help people with serious physical deformities and serious physical problems. There's nothing seriously wrong with that at all. You know, it's just, the point I'm trying to make is this. There's just simply a difference between what man does and what God does.
Oh, amen.
There's just
amen.
A difference between the two, but it doesn't mean what man does is evil, because many times the things we do for others are out of the right motive of the heart. Sometimes not, but most of the times, you know, people's hearts are at the right place. There's a sincere desire to help other people. You know, like, for instance, the difference between doctors or a nurse and God healing someone. But, you know, it's the same thing. Their hearts, doctors and nurses, I've ministered to them and even got them healed. And sometimes the process of them receiving from God is a little more difficult simply because they've had years of establishing their heart and natural knowledge. And when you've had years of, your heart, you're training your heart, establishing your heart to depend upon something and trust in something, then you just don't change very quickly sometimes. When your heart's trained in natural knowledge, that's very, very real to you. You know that little boy with autism, that weekend I prayed for him and I released the life of Christ in his body. And, you know, there was some change, but it was minor. I told the mother this, I said, he's healed. Now, I said that, though, with understanding. That wasn't just, quote, a faith statement, hoping that's what's going to happen in that context. No, that's not what I'm talking about. No, you see, when I release the life of Christ into someone's physical body, physical problems lose their ability to stay when it's Jesus. When it's a human helping someone, it's just the opposite. Because through natural means, then it's just how one human helps another human, and a person isn't free until they're completely successful at getting them free. And if a human helps another human and they get completely free, then it's a process, how one human helps another human. But when it's God, it's completely the opposite, because you see, when I put my hand on his head, he just pushed my hand away. Mm-hmm. That little boy didn't like anyone to touch him, mm-hmm. because he can't understand physical contact. His brain's not working right. He can't relate to you correctly. He can't communicate to you correctly because his own mother, he knocked our book table down before the meeting. She had to corral him and grab him because she talked to him. It was like going in one ear and out the other ear. He couldn't even communicate with her. He can't understand her communication, but there's a way of relating, a way she relates to him because she's the mother. She's the one that's been dealing with the problem all of these years. But you see, when she dropped him off at the special education school the next day, I guess it was Monday, she called me on the phone, I think maybe Tuesday or Wednesday or whatever it was, but when she dropped him off, these people, within no time, they're calling her on the phone. It's like, what has happened to your child? Because you see, there's a change, and they saw the change. Normally, he would wander in the hallways. They had to watch him all the time. He was a high-maintenance kid. If they didn't watch him all the time, then he could just go here, do this, wander around, and they had to kind of control him. But now he's staying in the classroom, and he's talking to them. And it's like, you know, what has happened to your child? And when she told them about prayer and told them about Jesus in prayer, their immediate response was no. No one gets free of autism. Because you see, they're trained in natural knowledge.
That's right.
Yes, it's an evil heart of unbelief, but they're not an evil person because they're just simply trained in natural knowledge. They know, according to their education, that no, it is not physically impossible. There's no means that man has of getting a person completely free of autism, even though they can help them to cope with life better. There's things they can do to help them. But you see, we're talking about the difference between the life of Christ and how a human helps someone.
Say that.
And when you come for prayer, then you see it's the life of Christ. See, my brother, in the addiction, there's an anointing that destroys the yoke.
That's it. That's right.
The Word of God is ministered with the intent for them to experience the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit will suddenly wham. With the help of the Holy Spirit, you can see something. You can see the Word from God's perspective. The Word goes beyond intellectual information with the help of the Holy Spirit. The Word of God is opened up to your heart, as Ephesians tells us, the eyes of 1:18, the eyes of our understanding being enlightened. Light, light, light. When light comes, darkness goes. Darkness speaks of, well, that lack of understanding, that confusion. To where it's just like you can't see clearly because your heart involves perception, how you perceive and see and understand. Where Jesus said in Matthew 5:8, blessed are the pure in heart, for you shall see God. And that word deceive in the Greek language means to perceive with the eyes of the heart. It's your ability to see things from God's perspective. And when you, when we get God's perspective in life, then our heart is in the process of opening up with understanding. And it is a process. That's just the importance of when the Holy Spirit is speaking, then you stay with that truth.
All right.
You allow the Word of God to completely open up, because you see, depending upon the condition of our heart, our unbelief can be very serious, because sometimes we've experienced challenging problems in life that are just not minor problems. They're the kind of issues and challenges that can dominate our heart because they're serious. They're not minor.
Mm-hmm.
They're challenging.
Yeah.
And so when the Spirit of God is opening up the Word of God to us with understanding, it's a process sometimes.
Right.
And when He's speaking, that's the time to give Him quality time.
Amen.
That's the time to really humble your heart to the place that you're going to refuse to exalt your heart through unbelief, because He's speaking. And if you have a contrary type of perspective on how you see it, you'll purposely humble your heart because you want His voice. You value His voice and you want His help. My sheep know my voice, John 10:27. My sheep know my voice, and you will know when He's speaking. Because you belong to Him. You'll recognize His voice.
Amen.
It's very, very clear. When the Word of God has been opened up to you, it becomes very, very clear.
Yes.
If we've had a lifetime of exalting our own heart and exalting our own voice, then sometimes our heart can be hardened.
Mm-hmm.
The book of Hebrews chapter 4 talks about the hardness of heart. And when our heart is insensitive to Him, it's only because we spend a lifetime of exalting our own heart, exalting our own beliefs. The way we see it. We've trained our heart in that. And so I'm telling you, this humility of heart is very, very important. When you look at, I've shared earlier with you, 1 Peter 5:7, casting anxiety upon the Lord. When you look at the previous scriptures in verse 5 and verse 6, then you find that the subject of submission being introduced. But you also find that in verse 6 that Peter begins to talk about this area of the mighty hand of God. Because every time you see the hand of God talked about in Scripture, then you're talking about experiencing the presence of the Lord. You're experiencing help by the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. Change comes by the Holy Spirit. Change doesn't come in us changing ourselves.
That's right. Yeah. Thank you.
We may choose by an act of our will to choose to believe something. We may choose to humble our heart, but that's the beginning of the process of change. Experiencing the Holy Spirit as our teacher is where true change comes, because there is a transformation that Romans chapter 12 talks about in the renewing of the mind, and that is a work of the Spirit of God. Have you established relationship with the Holy Spirit? Have you come to the place that you trust Him more than you trust yourself? Has that been proven to your heart? Because until that's proven to your heart, it's just something you're supposed to do. And you feel pressure like you're supposed to do something. I'll tell you what, when we experience His faithfulness to the point that the Word of God is opened up to us with understanding by the Spirit of God, when it's something, when His goodness is proven to our heart, it will give our heart confidence.
Amen.
It'll prove something to us that now I see it for myself, not because you say so.
Hello.
When you have your own experience, that's very, very important. It'll prove something to you. It'll give you confidence. And this is what we're talking about, the difference between living for God with just a bunch of intellectual information with a degree. Mm-hmm. I've got a doctorate degree.
Right.
I could have introduced as Dr. Paxton.
Right.
But can you imagine Dr. Jesus?
Hello.
Does that even sound normal?
Right.
And when you say His name, Jesus,
yes.
There's an intimacy that comes with that name. There's a closeness because, you see, He's real to us. He comes very personal to us. Because we've come to know the nature and character of the person and who He is.
Amen.
My, we've come to know His love for us. When you experience His love, then you're coming to know who He is.
That's right.
When that's proven to your heart and you really come to get a revelation of His love for you, it just changes the way you relate to Him because you won't hold Him in judgment for any of the bad in life.
Right.
Christians that hold God in judgment for bad do not know God. They don't know who He really is. They don't know the true nature and character of God. But it's a doctrine they've come up with because, you see, it just takes responsibility off of us to make Him responsible for all things, both good and bad. My, it takes responsibility off our heart. My. Especially when our heart lacks understanding in areas of the things that happen in life that we can't explain. But wisdom comes from above. James 1:5 promises wisdom. We're either going to pull within ourselves and form our own judgments of what truth is to us, or we're going to turn to Him and receive the wisdom that James 1:5 promises and experience. Wisdom is the practical understanding of the Word of God into everyday life. When that information has gone beyond just intellectual information to the knowledge of the Word of God, information, when it goes just beyond something you choose to believe, but it begins to become understanding to your heart, wisdom is a practical application of that truth into everyday life.
Amen.
It's how that truth is lived. All of a sudden, things begin to get clear to your heart. It begins to get simple, not complicated. When your heart straightens out, and that speaks of Jesus Christ to straighten the narrow, then things begin to get simple, not complicated.
That's right.
Amen.
Praise God.
That's right.
Amen.
But in coming to receive from God, if we come and we're making receiving about us coming because we need something, we want something, then our focus is on ourselves, our dependency is on self, and we don't realize it. I'm telling you, receiving is about Jesus. Even when you come for prayer, there should be a dependency on Him. It shouldn't be a dependency on the person to do something for you. If there's a dependency on the person to perform, to make something happen, then that's impersonal. You see, if receiving is not about Jesus, when you come for prayer, then you really aren't looking at Jesus. You're looking at a human to do something for you.
Hello.
Right.
Hello.
Amen.
But on the other hand, when you come to receive, if Jesus is the one you're receiving from, then that's just the vessel He's working through. But you've got a personal relationship with Him. He's your healer. He's the one that you're receiving from. That's just the vessel that He's working through. And so you're not looking at that person to do something for you because it's not, no, Lord, this is what I believe. And this is what I'm believing concerning this. And this is how it's going to manifest because it's happening now because my belief is in the now. And you're working through that individual. So it gets very personal in how you're believing. That's when you stop becoming a passive Christian.
All right.
Because a passive Christian is always looking for someone else to do it for them. And you'll discover that many times Christians that are consistently passive are not in the Word of God. They're not experiencing the help of the Holy Spirit with God's Word going beyond intellectual information. I tell you, maturity in our Christian walk is when it becomes about Jesus and not about us.
Hello.
We have a personal relationship with Him. And so when it comes to receiving, it's about Him. You see, today I'm beginning to talk to you about the prayer of faith. It's not a subject I talk about a lot, but I want to explain this from a different context today so you won't be, when you come, you won't be looking at a human to do something for you. No, it's Jesus. He's my healer. But in James chapter 5, it says this, starting in verse 14, "Is there any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord." Verse 15 says this, "And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if they have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another that you may be healed." Because why? "The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." Verse 17, "Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. Verse 18 says, "And he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit." Now Elijah, let's go to 1 Kings and just take a look at this, because you see, it says that he prayed in the description of the prayer he prayed. And James painted a picture for us. Without a picture, you just think, oh, he prayed. Mm-hmm. And a lot of Christians, when they pray, if there's a dependence upon self in prayer, then prayer will be about you. But it says here that the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. That is the heart of an individual that has changed in relationship to what you're praying about. And if you're talking about the area of healing as an example, it means that when it comes to physical problems, you don't respect physical problems. You don't put them in a place of prominence in your heart, to a place of unbelief, to the point that they're capable of influencing you on what truth is to your heart. You got no respect for them because of the blood of Jesus, because of his body and his blood. That becomes more precious and more virality to your heart. See, that's his foundational truth. When it comes to communion, when it comes to the death, the burial, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, these are areas that our hearts should have understanding as Christians, to the point that his blood is precious. To the point that we put that at a place of prominence. We absolutely refuse to respect physical problems and put them in a place of prominence and exalt them.
All right, come on.
Because it's what his body. We're talking about, I'm using the example of physical problems. I could talk about sin.
That's right.
Or I could talk about financial problems, relational problems. Whatever. It doesn't matter what the issues are, because you see, it's what Jesus accomplished for us. His blood is precious.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen.
There's nothing greater than his blood.
Nothing.
Amen.
But if we exalt the circumstances of life, then without realizing it, we're putting them in a place of prominence. Just like a minister I minister to that travels like myself and ministers, and he was sitting up on the front because I set him up there, because I didn't pray for him right away, because when he came for prayer, he was making receiving from God about me. He said, "Anointed minister, you can get me healed." Because he had two physical problems and that wouldn't go away, and he's been healed before. But he couldn't understand why these problems aren't leaving his body. In fact, they're getting worse, not better. So you heard about me, heard about what God was doing through me. And so he came thinking, okay, his perspective was, "You're anointed of God. God, yo, this is must be a serious, more powerful problem, because there needs somebody with a more powerful anointing." Well, instead, I had him sit down and prepare his heart to receive from the Lord, because he was making receiving about me, not about Jesus. And I had him sit down and humble his heart. Because the first thing I had him do was to laugh and ridicule and make fun of the problems. Instead of exalting them and put them in a place of prominence and heart, how he's believing. Sit down here and make fun of them, ridicule them, laugh at them, mock them.
Hello.
But yeah, that's just the opposite of what we do sometimes in the natural realm with our problems, whether they're financial, whether they're relationship problems or physical. We have the tendency to exalt them. Allow them to have magnitude within our heart and how we're believing. No, laugh at them, mock them, ridicule them, put them down. No, you put the blood of Jesus at a place of prominence, because that's the second thing I had that man do. And I'm not talking to a baby Christian, I'm talking to a minister. When I told him this, the second thing was to take the blood of Jesus and put it at a place of prominence and exalt it in his heart and how he's believing. Let me tell you, all kinds of scriptures opened up to him, because he's not a novice in the Word of God. It's like we all do sometimes when the Holy Spirit turns on the light. It's like we're shocked back to reality. It's like, what have I been doing? It's like, I know this. It's like, what have I been doing? It's like, it's not Jesus. He starts to become more real again. That's what happened with that man. And he humbled his heart. He did that. When I, you know, I continued the altar call, ministering to people, but when I came back over to him, he had his head down, and I came back over when I was free, and I put my hand on his head, released the life of Christ, and immediately those physical problems, both of them began to leave his body. Immediately they began to leave right at that moment.
Jesus.
And the reason they were leaving was this. It was the life of Christ setting him free. And when physical problems are leaving because Jesus is the one that's healing you, when it's his life, his presence, his anointing, his virtue that is setting you free, then what actually happens is physical problems die. They lose their ability to stay in life and live and stay in the human body. That's why you get better. If you don't have that kind of perspective established in your heart in relationship to physical problems, then you won't understand when someone's getting better. You just think, well, they're just better, but they're not healed yet. If that's your perspective as a Christian, you've got the wrong perspective. If I had that perspective as a minister when I pray for people, I would limit Jesus working through me. Just like a young man that had problems with his eyes, and I was releasing the life of Christ in his eyes, and I had him look. He said, well, it's better. And then I hadn't turned back around. I started talking to him and giving some insight and just talking to him. And then I said, okay, look again. He said, well, it's even better. And I got to talking to him again. And then I went back and said, okay, now look again. My eyes are even better. He was getting better and better and better because I released the life of Christ into his body. But if he'd had the perspective of a lot of Christians, he would think, well, like some Christians, like this lady I prayed for one time who had a problem with her back, and she had a problem with her congestion in the lungs, and she wanted to be able to see without her glasses. The back was healed immediately. I mean, man, she couldn't make that back hurt. Her lungs just opened right up. All that congestion went, because it wasn't extremely serious, but what was there just went to the point, she said, oh, yeah, that's good. It feels good. And then I took my hands off her eyes, and she said, well, it's better, but it's not perfect. Accenting what she didn't receive over what she received. That will reveal your heart when bad is more real in your heart than the goodness of God, the good that you're experiencing right now.
Right.
Let me tell you, when it's not a human helping you, when it's the life of Christ setting you free, physical problems lose their ability to stay in the physical body. That's the fig tree that Mark chapter 11 that Jesus was talking about, because you see, his own disciples had the wrong perspective and he corrected them. He said, no, have faith in God, not man, God.
Hello.
Not on yourself. Stop having a human perspective in relationship to physical problems. Stop looking the way, stop thinking that way. Stop relating that way. Have faith in God, because they weren't trusting God. They were trusting in the human perspective. That's trusting in self, how I see it, because that's just what truth is to me. That's just the way I see it. But it's real to us. We do really think sometimes we're so right in the way we see something, because because truth is found in our problems sometimes instead of the Word of God. Truth is found in Jesus Christ. He is the Word. Truth is found in Him. And that's why he talked to him about the mountain, speaking to the mountain, because you see, everything about the mountain was to explain that when you speak to a mountain in your heart, it better not be a mountain, because there can't be doubt. If the problem is exalted in your heart, you're not prepared to speak to the mountain.
Hello.
I'm telling you, it may be a mountain in life, but in your heart, it better not be a mountain.
Hello.
You better have God's perspective to the point that nothing's greater than the blood of Jesus. Absolutely nothing's greater than his blood. And so I refuse to respect you. I refuse to put you to a place of prominence. Because you're nothing compared to the blood of Jesus. That better be your human, deep within your heart, that better be real, not just something you choose to believe. It better be real to your heart. So take time. Allow the Holy Spirit to be your teacher, to open up that truth to you. Meditate on it. Ponder, consider. Take time. You don't have to be in a hurry.
Yes.
We don't have to be pushed as Christians. We don't have to strive. We enter a rest. It's just not a place of passivity. It's a place where we cease from our own labors. Our own human effort. We stop trying to live for him and let him live his life through us.
Amen.
Just making sense.
Amen. 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 Thank you.
You see, the prayer of faith, it's the effective, fervent prayer. This is what comes out of the heart of an individual that's got no respect for physical problems, because you see, it's real. It's effective because it's fervent. You mean what you say what you mean.
Yes.
Whether you're a meek, quiet, kind of an individual, it doesn't matter. When it comes to a physical problem, it's like, it just comes out of you. You don't have to have my personality like knock something over like a bulldog in a china cabinet, so to speak. But the thing is, though, within your heart, it's how you relate. because you've got beliefs established in Christ Jesus established within your heart when it comes to physical problems. You got no respect for physical problems because they're evil. They hurt people. Physical problems hurt people. They're evil. That, let me tell you, the freedom that little boy is experiencing is good. Because it's evil for a little boy not to receive love from his own mother. See, a mother called me on the phone on Tuesday or Wednesday, whenever it was, and the thing is, she had him in her lap. She could hold him now. She could hug her own child now. But more than that, he told her this, and he can talk to her now. He said, "Mom, now I'm not alone." And he was never physically alone. But it didn't matter if he was with people. He felt alone. That's evil. Physical problems are evil. They hurt people. So do not respect them.
Thank you.
Hmm.
Thank you. Hallelujah.
You see, I'm going to touch on this, and I've got enough time to go into the depth I'd like to, but James 5, is there any sick among you? Call for the elders of the church. Now, we're talking about those whose hearts with understanding know what they're doing. And let them pray over him, anointed with oil in the name of the Lord, because oil speaks of the Holy Spirit, because you see, it's a Spirit of God you're going to be releasing. It's not a human getting another person free through human means. Right. It's not just positive kind of thinking.
Thank you.
It's not a human effort. It's the life of Christ you're releasing right out of your spirit, wham, right into a person's physical body. It brings change. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. And if you're committing sins, he shall be forgiven him. So confess your faults one another that you may be healed. And we're talking about faults. We're only talking about the issues of the heart, opening up our heart so that there's no issue of unbelief, that where the heart is exalted, where it's all about me, where I don't feel worthy to receive because of issues concerning me, because receiving is about Jesus and he made us worthy. Our righteousness is in him. So we're changing the way we're relating. Confession isn't about, okay, well, God and out, we'll forgive you now that you confessed it. No, you're already forgiven. It's just an issue of heart. If there is an issue within the heart, if there is an issue that is causing unbelief to the point that you're limiting Jesus in your life because of the way you're relating to life in the area of an issue of sin or relational. But it says, Elijah was a like man, subject to passions like we are. In other words, there's no difference between Elijah than us. And you may want to put him in a place of prominence and put him up on a pedestal, but the fact is this, the scripture makes it clear, he was a man of like passions. And so it was Jesus. It was the Spirit of the Lord that was working through him. It was what God was doing in his life. It wasn't what he was doing for God.
That's it. Thank you.
I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost will make you look good.
Yes, he will.
Because it's about Jesus. It's not about us.
That's right.
We've learned to live life with a dependency on the life of Christ from within. Man, powerful things. See, my grandfather during the Depression did something that made him look really good, but it was God. He became known as a great man of faith. Because if you know anything and understand anything about the Depression, it's like people just couldn't get money. But during the Depression, he had their savings was $400. That was a lot of money in the Depression. He was a lawyer, and you know what? But he took his home and split it in half and rented out part of it, because a lot of people did a lot of things to help survive and do things in the Depression to make things happen in life. But you know, he lacked a lot of understanding of the Word of God because he had a denominational background. But he did hear from God, and the Lord spoke to him to give that money away to the pastor. It turned out the pastor needed that exact amount of money and was believing God for it in the Depression. That's like almost like $1 million, so to speak. Because that's a lot of money in the Depression. And he gave it to him. His wife hit the roof. It's like, you gave away our nest egg. You gave away the one thing that was always there that we could trust in. Man, her heart just like, she lost it. But he felt it was God. And during the Depression, a person that owed him money paid, and that money came back. And it was just like, wow, it proves something to his heart. Helped his wife to begin the process of change, but it proves something to his heart. Gave him confidence. And the church is like, wow, great man of faith. No, it's not about a great man of faith. No, it was about the fact that when we change, we're capable of trusting Jesus. And I'm going to tell you again, the Holy Spirit will make us look good because he heard from God. He acted on what he heard.
Thank you.
It wasn't something he did in the arm of the flesh. Well, if I do this, God will do this for me.
Right.
That's all out of your intellect.
Uh-huh.
He heard from God and did what he said and got his results. My sheep know my voice. But you see, my father is an example of this prayer, because in his Baptist background, you see, my father, when he was young, he was running a race, he was fast, but he collapsed. And during that time in our history, there was polio in this nation, and he got struck with polio, and he went from being very strong as a young man to eventually bedfast, and he'll never walk again with his hips deteriorating. And you see, one thing he did different was this. He could have consumed his heart with himself. He could have felt sorry for himself. He could have said, well, why me? You know, why is this happening to me? He could even blame God and hold God in judgment in his heart. Why is God doing this to me? Because that's what a lot of Christians do. That's how they're taught. That's how some Christians teach. That God did this to you. He's just teaching you something. Would you do that to your children?
Come on.
You'd probably go to prison if you did.
Come on.
Because it's evil. Is God evil?
No.
No, God's not responsible for bad. Because he put all, Galatians 3:13, he put all the bad on Jesus. He proved his love towards us through Jesus Christ. He is love. He is not the author of evil.
Amen.
Evil didn't come into the world until man gave place to the devil. That's when evil came in the garden at the beginning. That's when it began. My, God is not the author. It doesn't come from him. He's good. He's good all the time. Oh. He's responsible for good. You got to be able to trust him. So you got to know his true nature and character.
Yeah. Come on.
But you see, my father did something that was unique. As a young man, he was in the Word of God. He was reading his Bible, and he came across this passage in James chapter 5. And he said, Mom, why can't the elders of the church pray for me? And she said, well, I don't see any reason why they can't. And that pastor and those people that came over, they probably did, well, sure, we'll come over and pray. You know what? It's not something they normally do. But in the Word, I believe it was my father's heart that was responding. He was responding with the Word in his heart. And so they're coming over to pray. Yeah, they probably did not pray the prayer of faith. Because they probably didn't have understanding and with their heart. They probably had unbelief. They'll probably do it because, oh, poor guy. Well, of course, this young man, of course, we'll be glad to come over and pray for him and such. They probably prayed a prayer of unbelief. I've been in situations like that as a minister. I'm in one hospital situation where I had to let the other ministers go first and leave so that I could minister,
right,
be respectful and not do something. But all of a sudden, they realize there's a major difference between us and you.
Thank you.
And I let them leave so that I could minister effectively. Because they were relating one way that was going to let the person keep the problem. But I was waiting until they leave so I wouldn't offend someone, because, you see, I'm going to release the life of Christ to kill the problem.
Hello. Thank you.
It was a freedom that Christ set us free. Galatians 5:1. We're not to be subject again to yoke of slavery, not to live like slaves in relationship to life. Uh-uh. We're not slaves. We need to establish an identity of freedom to the place that we live free. Even when there's problems, it's like, no, uh-uh, I'm free.
Free.
It's how you relate. I'm free. This belongs to Jesus. I'm free. It's how you relate. You see, from that day, his mother said this. From that day of prayer, he began to get better. And he eventually went to the place. The doctor said, you'll never walk again. It's physically impossible. He went to crutches. The doctor said, you'll be on crutches the rest of your life. He went to cane. He said, you'll have that cane the rest of your life. I never remember my dad with a cane. But I inherited the cane because our grandfather carved it out of the last few feet of an oak tree. It's a beautiful design. But you see, because he got better and better and better, because the life of Christ was working in him the whole time. It's how he set his heart, because how he was believing. When the prayer of faith shall save the sick. You see, the thing about Elijah, and you go back to 1 Kings chapter 18, is this. I just want to quickly share this perspective. I don't have time to go into the depth I'd like to. But in chapter 18, starting in verse 41, and talking about the abundance of rain, and because, you see, it hadn't rained, but you see, now there he is with the king, but the time came he went to pray. And it's what Elijah did in verse 43. He's after prayer, after this fervent, effective prayer, then it's what he did. You see, he prayed the prayer, but you're not seeing anything yet with your eyes. But when he prayed, though it's what he was believing in his heart. So he sent the servant to look for rain. So the servant went to look out of the ocean and look at a distance to see if there, and it was like nothing. And he came back with, you know what he came back? It's like, no rain. When you don't see what you believe in, how do you relate? How do you respond? Look what was in Elijah. Look what was in his heart. It's like, this man is like, he's not moved. You know, one of the things the scriptures he's here is not really expounding. We're not seeing any issue come out of the heart of the servant. So obviously there was no serious issue of unbelief in relationship. But you see, he sent him seven times. I wonder how many people can keep looking for good over and over and over. And after a while, the bad becomes too real because you're not seeing good.
Yeah, come on.
In the process of change, even when we're experiencing change in the Word of God, and when that process of change, there's some people that give up in their heart because it's like bad is just too real. Are you doing something daily for the benefit of your heart while under the weight of the problems to the point that you're changing the way you're relating to the problems? Because change is a process. But Elijah wasn't having to do that because he was already, there already was truth established deep down on the inside, even to the point that it's like, go back. You see, Elijah's the one that kept sending the servant back. Go back. We don't see any attitude coming out of the servant after the second or the third or the fourth time. You don't see him saying something like, well, maybe you ought to go inquire of the Lord. Maybe you ought to go ask him. Because you know what? It's just not working. A human perspective, because you're not seeing what you want to see. I'm telling you what, a person that understands, a person with understanding, established their heart, that has that type of understanding by the Spirit of God, your beliefs don't change because they're found in Christ Jesus. You just absolutely refuse to change the way you relate. It's like, no, you're changing, problem. No, he's the same. He never changes.
Yep.
He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He just simply, Jesus doesn't change.
Yep.
It's who he is.
That's right.
Now, are you living in him, who you are in him? Are you living for him? Are you living in self with a dependence on self? What truth is established deep within your heart in relationship to life? Because it's like, no, you're moving. Do you have that type of determination, that effectiveness on the inside of you to the point that it's like, no, you're leaving?
Amen.
There's people that look at the problems, determine what's truth, especially in healing. That sometimes people talk about other people to prove what is truth to their heart, to prove the unbelief. You know, like, well, so-and-so was a man of faith, but he died and went to heaven. It didn't work for him. Look, only God knows the heart of an individual. You don't know a heart unless God reveals it.
Amen.
You can't judge another person because you're not God. You can look at the circumstances. You may have a perspective. You may come to a human judgment. But until you get understanding by the Spirit of God, you don't know. Even Andrew Womack, a friend of mine, I mean, he went in a situation with a man one time. And man, they went there after church because he was going to die. And they prayed for him. And everybody left the room. Andrew went back in, walked up to him and said, what do you really believe in God for concerning your healing? And before he was saying, praise God, glory, you know, and saying all the right things. But he walked back in there and said, what do you really believe in God for concerning your healing? And the man said, well, I'm just believing I'm going to die and go to heaven. But I'm going along with this so I don't hurt my wife. You don't know what's in the heart of an individual. You know what they're really believing. You don't know where they're really at. Some people choose to go home. There's been elderly people that it's like, you know, I just heard of a situation with a lady, and even the wife stopped praying when the husband said, no, I want to go home. She stopped speaking and confessing because that's where his heart was at. That's what he's believing for. If you want to go home, you can go home. I can give lots of testimonies on that line and share stories with you. People that wanted to go home and chose to go home. You'll have a wonderful time in heaven.
Right.
If you want to live, freedom is found in Christ Jesus. You see, he sent him and kept sending him until the point that the seventh time, then he saw a cloud the size of a man's hand coming up out of the sea. That's all it took for Elias. Because it's like, go tell the king, run, go. And the Spirit of God, the hand of God, the scripture says, came upon him. I was talking about 1 Peter chapter 5, the hand of God earlier. Man, let me tell you, when the Spirit of God, the hand of God comes upon you, it's powerful what's going to happen. Because it's what God's doing through you. You're not doing it for him. You're experiencing him. The hand of God came upon him. He made it back to the city before the king. That's supernatural. That's God. You try out running a horse in a chariot. Go give it a try. That's just God. That's supernatural. But man, the rain came, but all it took was a cloud the size of a hand. When you see good, do you own good? Does that prove it? It's like, you're free, but it's only the size of a hand. I'll tell you, when you own good, identify with good, that's all it takes. It's like, there it is. It's yours. When you experience the goodness of God, when the life of Christ is released and you're in the area of healing, you're experiencing good. When you begin to get better, how do you relate? Do you believe you're free? Or do you see yourself in the process of getting free?
Right.
That's how when a human is helping you, like a doctor is an example, then it can be a process sometimes, and where they're helping us and we can get better. They can stay with it, do different things sometimes. That's how one human helps another human. Or you're in a financial need. You go to your mother. And your mom loans you money.
Right.
And so you've got at least some money, but the need's greater, but at least she gave you some money. Mm-hmm. You're just in the process. Mm-hmm. You're not completely free yet. Sometimes things can be a process, how one human helps another human.
Right.
But I'm gonna tell you something, when it comes to receiving from God, it's just the opposite of how you receive from a human, because we're receiving because of the cross, because of Jesus Christ, which means this, every bit of it's mine right now. And the moment you see good, it's like, no, that's it. I've got it all. You relate completely differently because we're talking about the cross. Well, Matthew 8:17 that I've shared here before, he himself took our infirmities and bore our sickness. He took them. He bore them. Now, is that the way you relate to a physical problem in your body or problems in your body? Do you, even though they're in your body, do you see them as belonging to Jesus? In relationship to the problem, does it belong to Jesus, or do you have a problem where you need to be free? Because if you have a problem where you need to be free, then you're relating incorrectly to the problem, because all of our needs have been met in Christ Jesus, Philippians 4:19. That's foundational truth. We're not needy people. We're not supposed to relate to life where I'm constantly in need, constantly in lack, where lack belongs to you, where lack is always there. All of our needs are met in Christ Jesus. You got to change the way you relate. Because the problem belongs to Jesus. As Christians, we relate differently because of Jesus Christ. No, this belongs to Jesus. It does not belong to me. I don't even care if I'm responsible for it being in my body. It still belongs to Him. Because receiving is about Him. It's not about me. He's my righteousness. My righteousness is not found in my own good works. It's not found in what I do. It's found in Him. He gets all the glory. We don't look at self and exalt self. It's about Jesus Christ.
Right.
No, in relation to the problem, the way you initially rate, the way you continually relate is, no, you belong to Jesus. No, when you leave my body right now, no, the life of Christ has set me free now. That's Romans 8:2. It's the law of the Spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus, which have set me free from the law of sin and death. So it belongs to Jesus, and no, your life is setting me free now. This is what's This is where the problem's going. It's leaving my body. Whatever the problem is, it's like, oh, you know, it's leaving. This is leaving. Yeah. Your beliefs are very, very specific because it belongs to Jesus.
Amen.
It's how you relate.
Come on.
My. You don't have to prove something to someone else. You don't have to promote unbelief out of someone else's heart, which is detrimental to your heart. This is something that happens within your heart. It's how you relate. Until unbelievers see that we relate to life differently.
Right.
If they see we relate to life the same way they do, we consume our heart with anxiety and life's problems to the point that they dominate our heart all the time. That's all they see, is that we have one problem after the other problem, and there's just anxiety coming out of this in relationship to problems. It's just like they always dominate our heart, and we're always talking the problems, always speaking the problems, always feeling sorry for ourselves and feeling bad about self and exalting self and our beliefs. They won't see Jesus. In a very, very practical way, they won't see Jesus. They've got to see there's something different how we relate to life. That relating to life is about Jesus Christ. We're finding our life in Him, not in ourselves.
Thank you.
Is this making sense?
Yes. Amen. Amen.
My.
Yes. My. Holy
Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Just like that young man I was ministering to, and he kept getting better and better and better. And I would just talk to him for a few minutes and have him look again, because I released the life of Christ right in his body. But if he had put his focus on himself, and if he would have, in relationship to the problem, saw himself, well, it's a little better, but it's not perfect like that lady did. then he would have owned the problem. He would have seen himself as having a problem where he's not free yet, and Jesus needed to do more for him. He wouldn't have understood receiving. Instead, I took some time to explain, but him kept looking. And then we're right back to ministering some truth to him because this was all new to him. He wasn't used to hearing these types of truths and relating this way. But he was hearing truth and experiencing truth, and it proved something to his heart. He gave his heart confidence. I'm telling you, the moment you experience good, you just come unglued in the goodness of God. You got something to rejoice about because good belongs to you because of Jesus Christ. He took all of the bad. He took the curse. Good belongs to you. Praise God. My. I think sometimes as teachers, we never finish. We just stop. But I'll say this, that I forgot to mention this. If you want to be on our mail list back there, you can give us your information. If you want to be in our video email, like a little mini television showing about email, then just give us your email address. We'll put you on that. And also, our tape catalog's back there with more information about teachings. Feel free to grab one of those. And then also, this is talking about our building. I forgot to mention our building earlier that I think we're, for those that are, I know we got some partners here with us, and I'm grateful for our partners. You're a part of what God's doing through us as a ministry. And so I think we're down to 94,000 on our building, and originally it was over $500,000. And so, and it's just beautiful. In fact, it's where our television is up there, our studio, as well as our training center, as well as our offices. In fact, that's one of the things that the Lord's been speaking. In fact, I've gotten three words at different, every place I've gone. It was like I kept getting the same word. That'll get your attention when people keep saying the same thing, different people saying it. But I've been on television. The Lord spoke to me. He's been speaking to me about television because, the last time I was on television, the Lord put us on in an area where I wasn't prepared to go on, but it was like, no, he's doing it. And he put us on in an area that was like the worst area to go on television. It's like you don't go on television there because the area is a wrong belief system throughout that area. It's been there for over 100 years. And it's just like hard hearts. But you see, first time we held a meeting in a church from television, the church was packed out. And a third of the people that raised their hand was Baptist. And the other third of the people raised their hand was Catholic. The other third of the people was full gospel, different churches. And you see, I had a meeting one time where four pastors came. They wouldn't listen to Andrew, is what I was told. But after listening to me, then three of them started listening to Andrew. Because grace takes a revelation. It can challenge some people's hearts to the point they just put up a wall of resistance. But all of a sudden, they set up a consistent teaching the Word of God. I was doing a seminar on a Saturday for about 6 hours, 3 a.m, 3 p.m, and their hearts changed, and they realized there's something more. And you see, until your will is involved, until there's a willingness coming from your will, until you submit in that area, you don't start seeking truth and allowing the Holy Spirit to be your teacher. But three of them, see, that's one of the strengths, I guess, I'm sharing that God has put within us as a ministry, is that we minister across denomination lines. And so there's I have a lot of testimonies I can share in that area. Even some friends of ours that God is just utilizing in that area in the days that we're in, what God's doing. And so there's just some powerful things happening. I could share testimonies with you, but I'll share this also, our partnership packet. If you want to be a part, there's even a partnership in there about television as well as other business partnerships and different types. If you want to be a part of what the Lord's doing through us, the Lord speak to your heart, then grab one of those. You see, you never have to do anything. As a Christian, you just get to. When you have the right understanding established in your heart, then you never feel pressure when it comes to finances or ministers talking about money because you never have to do anything. No, when you have the right understanding, it's about Jesus, and you just simply want to be a part of what he's doing in the earth. That's when my heart changed as a Christian because when it's my young spirit-filled days, I used to listen. Well, the first pastor, and he was talking about giving and money, and I just looked at him and said, yeah, you just want my money. And that was my perspective until the Word of God reached my heart with understanding, and I changed. And when I changed, it was like, no, Lord, I want to be a part of what you're doing in the earth. And so with the right motive and intent of the heart, then I became a part. Praise God. My, thank you. Did you want to take over, brother, and I'll come back up and minister? Okay, thank you.